Welcome, everyone. As Tricia pointed out to me as we were preparing for the lecture, you came on a snowy tax day. And it's true. It's sort of stunning that it would be April 15th and it would be snowy, but thanks for coming. I'm Sarah Turner. I'm the dean at the Academy. It's nice to see you, students. Thanks for coming when I know it's a busy end of the semester and a busy install. And thanks to the folks who aren't students. It's always nice to see people from off campus coming to the lecture, so thanks for being here. Tonight, I'm really pleased to have Guna Nadarajan joining us and to welcome him as a new and very prominent member of what I think of as the Southeast Michigan cultural community. So it's nice to have him to campus to get to hear a little of his thoughts. Guna Nadarajan is an art theorist and a curator working at the intersections of art, science, and technology. And in 2012, he became the dean of the Penny Stamp School of Art and Design at the University of Michigan, so not very far away. He's an accomplished art writer, an editor, a theorist, and he's published widely. I'm going to read out some of those publications to you, but as I read, the thing that I notice the most is the range of cities that these projects have happened in, and I think about him traversing the globe, literally, to get this work done. He's written Construction Site from 2004 and Contemporary Art in Singapore, Place Studies in Art, Media, Science, and Technology, Historical Investigations on the Sites and Migration of Knowledge, The Handbook of Visual Culture, and 100 chapters in books, catalog essays, academic articles, reviews, and all of these forms of writing have been translated into, I think, about 14 languages. So not only is he moving around the world, but his ideas and his writing are too. He's curated 20 international exhibitions, including Ambulations in Singapore, a Media City in Seoul, Negotiating Spaces in Auckland, Dense Local in Mexico City. He's been a contributing curator for Documenta 11, and in 2006 for the Singapore Biennial. He served on the jury of international exhibitions all around the world in Helsinki, in San Jose, and in Manchester. He was the artistic co-director of the Ogaki Biennial in Japan and the artistic director of the International Symposium on Electronic Art in Singapore. So you see what I mean, moving all around. His curatorial practice is innovative, it's fresh. And as an example of this, in his first curatorial role when he arrived at the University of Michigan, he asked the faculty to submit an object or a thing from their own studio or workspace that would constitute an essential part and be a meaningful introduction to their work. And through this, he created an exhibition that sought to highlight the processes of the creative work of his faculty members. And in that, opened the floor for conversations on creative work in today's practice in art and design. So you've heard about his robust international scholarly and writing record. He's built an exciting and diverse network, one that he's been very generous to share with our community through informal partnerships, in sharing lecturers that come to the Penny Stamps program. And he's also offered a home to many of our alumni as they start out in their first teaching positions, a relationship that I know that we'll be able to continue. So even though he's only been here for 2 short years, it's really impressive his dedication to investing in the art and the thinking of our Southeastern Michigan. So please welcome this new leader in art and design, Guna Nadarajan.
Thank you, Sarah, for the very kind introduction. Just gonna take a bit of water. First of all, it's really nice to be here in Cranbrook. I've always admired this institution. It's an incredible institution which has produced some amazing artists and designers, and I think you should be very proud about what you have achieved in this institution. And I hope that we can continue to have discussions and interactions between our institutions, because I think we in Michigan would be better because our institutions are stronger and they are collaborating and working together. So, when Sarah suggested that I come and give a talk about my work or some aspect of what I do, I have a broad range of sometimes very eclectic interests, and a lot of it sometimes becomes takes a written form, not because I want it to, but because it wants to. it becomes written up as an essay, or it becomes part of a book, or it becomes a book, because that's where my thoughts have tended me towards. But I've found very much that what I love most, and what I love because of how much I grow as a person, is curating. Curating is one of those things that I do always together with other people. It allows me an opportunity to learn from someone else, because together we are thinking about the problem and coming up with ways of exemplifying it, materializing it, sharing it, that is larger than how I might have started the journey. My curatorial projects, there are a lot of them that I could share with you, but I decided what I'll do is I'll share with you just a few examples of curatorial projects I've engaged in, and I'll end off a little bit talking about a couple of projects I'm working on right now, and then we can have some questions and can talk more about this. So I wanted to first begin by talking about how I think about curating, and I gave a sort of a hint when I said, look, you know, I think about it as something I always do together with others. There are many other things that I think are not so much peculiar to me, but these are things that I hold as principles or important issues or ways of thinking and doing that I think becomes a kind of a curatorial approach for me. I am, in terms of exhibitions, I always think about exhibitions not as a presentation of something already resolved. You know, I find it very unexciting when there is a body of work already in existence and I'm asked to pull them together to make a show of it. I find that uninteresting, not because the works are uninteresting, but because I don't get to engage in a discussion that where the work and I co-evolve. So it's in a very strange way, it's a selfishly oriented other orientation. But I see exhibitions always as a way of working through ideas that are half formed in my mind, and that's where they are best. I find them exciting exactly because they are half formed. I don't need to resolve everything, and in fact, that's exactly why I will tend to work with someone else who might have far more interesting insights than I would by myself. So I see exhibitions as the working through rather than the presentation of something already done. I see it as a collaborative enterprise, something that I always enjoy doing with others. And it's collaborative, meaning we labor together rather than just one of us deciding what things would happen and how they would happen. I see it as generative, meaning that it does not start with something already there, but it gets generated and emerges as a result of the interaction. It is almost always co-conceived and co-developed. I'm a real history buff. I have a very large library, and most of those books are history books, simply because I'm interested in the history of things, of phenomena, of countries, of people, of behaviors, and part of it is just that I find that history helps us to understand how some things came to be, and therefore understand how they could well have been otherwise. So history teaches us the possibilities of time and movement and materials. And I find it extremely useful when I'm thinking about any exhibition project, any curatorial project. I always start with doing a huge amount of historical work on the subject itself. My curatorial practice is media non-specific, meaning I've worked with a variety of media practitioners, whether they are painters, sculptors, media artists, animators, video artists. It really doesn't matter to me. What's most important is that we engage in a discussion that where the work becomes becomes co-formed as a result of it. This part is a very important, increasingly important part of what I and how I work. I don't make any distinction between art and other things, and I really mean other things. I have been increasingly finding ways to place objects that do not constitute art objects. They have not been intended as art. They are not from the art world, to speak Danto. They have none of those, none of the aura of artworks. But these are regular things that placed side by side with art objects, with other objects, create new meanings, new possibilities. And I'll talk a bit about this in some of my future projects when I get to that. I think it really doesn't make sense for us to think about exhibitions or curatorial projects without understanding the site and the culture within which you're operating. I enjoy working in other cultures, in other places, and I in fact even willfully try and displace myself in those spaces because I want to feel the discomfort that comes with that and that allows me to learn something that I did not know before I started. I think a site and where you undertake an exhibition is not just an empty space that you put something in. It is a living space with people and histories and ideas that are circulating around it. It has its own material practices and conditions. One needs to regard it if one wants to really engage the artwork or the exhibition and locate it in that space. I'm extremely interested in science and technology and the interactions between science and technology and the arts. And I say this partly as a result of realizing, in fact, partly as a result of being interested in art, science, and technology, I have had to revalue, or at least reevaluate, some of my own presumptions about objects and what space they inhabit, what meanings and universes of meanings they inhabit. Typically, I have worked to bring artists and scientists together. Artists working with new technologies to work with other with technological researchers. I have placed artists in research labs in scientific research labs as residents. I find those occasions where the kind of active interaction happens between art and science and technology really fruitful, and I've done a lot of projects around that. Finally, one point about being disruptive. I think that art, especially art, and this is where I truly feel that I, as much as I do not make a distinction between art and other things, I really think that art has as one of its essential persuasions, the idea of disrupting the norm, disrupting the ways in which we do things, the way in which we see things. And I mean that when I say I undertake curatorial projects with an approach to disrupt the common ways in which we are thinking about something. Hopefully some of the projects I'm going to highlight will show you some aspects of this. Okay, so ambulations. As I said before, I have a whole set of very eclectic interests. So between 97 and, I love walking. It's one of those things that I truly, truly enjoy. And that's why it's especially frustrating with Michigan weather. but anyway, that aside, I have always enjoyed walking, and I've enjoyed the ways in which walking figures in our culture. And in between 97 and 98, I became actively interested in the notion of walking, and I did a lot of research around it. Sometimes I just spent time looking at people walking. I spent a lot of time watching videos, looking at films, looking at the gaits of different actors. I did research on city planning and street design and stairwells and staircases and ladders and footwear. And so it was every aspect of walking that I could think of. And as I was doing this research, and I really did not know what I was going to do with it. I was just interested in walking for a while. So I began talking to a number of people. I began talking to a number of poets. I talked to a number of artists, some architects, some designers. And they also became somewhat interested in the idea. So we started talking more about this. And we had a couple of really intense meetings talking about walking in different forms. And somewhere along the way, someone suggested, oh, why don't we do an exhibition of sorts? I said, well, yeah, that sounds like a good idea. But I said, but what do I do with all these things I've accumulated, you know, in terms of my research? So I said, okay, I'll think about that later, but let's do this. So we worked from 98 till late 99. December 99, we had an exhibition, Ambulations. Ambulations was basically an attempt to try and think about walking in as in all its different ways in which walking gets elaborated in our culture, in our art forms, in our architecture, and in our own behavior, and in our philosophy, in our painting. So I invited 17 artists to respond to the idea of walking. And one of the artists was Richard Long, who is an important artist known for his long walks that he has made in a variety of environments. So that exhibition opened in Singapore in 99. And this is one of the works that was done by Amanda Heng, a Singapore artist, performance artist, who is a feminist artist, very interested in the idea of, and she was very interested in the idea of how women were not allowed to walk in the streets. And she was, I mean, it was fascinating talking to her because, you know, she was saying things and I was thinking, this is what Virginia Woolf was saying 100 years ago, you know, like, it was really fascinating talking to her as she started developing a project. This is a work by Ye Shu Fang, another Singapore artist. So what this is, to give you a context, this is a small gallery that was completely filled with jelly. So the aga-aga is a Malay word for jelly. And so we filled the entire gallery to about just about the shin height. On the opening night, people were encouraged to come and walk in the jelly. And then after they had walked and left, the artists poured colored jelly into those footprints. It was a fascinating project to work with. I mean, this entire project was really great to work with, simply because I learned so much about walking and how people had different presumptions about what walking is and how little thinking has been given to walking. It's interesting because right after this exhibition, there were four new books that came out around walking. One of the books was Wanderlust, which some of you may know about. This also led me to finish up all the research I did. I put it together into a small book called Ambulations, which was a compilation of reflections on painting and walking and philosophy. You know, philosophers have prided in writing a lot of their philosophical texts while walking. Rousseau was an important philosopher who wrote while walking. Nietzsche said, you cannot actually have good thoughts without while your stomach is crunched, and therefore you need to walk. And so there was a whole celebration of walking in philosophy and in painting. And I also had entire sections on street design and how street design evolved in relation to walking. So it was a really fun project, and it really was a formative project for me in terms of thinking about my own ideas as a curator. So the next project was, again, I did many projects in between, but I'm just highlighting a few. The next project I thoroughly enjoyed was Toys. So Toys was based on my discomfort with museum spaces. I've always been very uncomfortable with the don't touch this, don't do that, mentality of museums. And I found it extremely problematic to think about how do we engage a public? How do we talk about exhibitions when the exhibition context is an inhibitory one? So I've really enjoyed ways of disrupting the economy of the spatial economies and the disciplinary economies of museums and galleries. Another aspect of this was my interest in play. I was researching at a certain point. I was researching a lot about play, reading different philosophers about play, looking at the history of toys, looking at the relationship between play and rituals and anthropological texts, looking at play itself as a human activity, play among animals. So all of that came together at some point. And again, similarly, I talked to a number of artists and designers about what they were doing, and I said, look, you know, I'm really interested in this play thing, in, you know, about toys. And there were, interestingly, a number of artists who were making interesting works that had play as one of its principal elements, and some of them who were actually making very purposefully toy-like things. And, you know, the history of toys, if you've not had a chance to have a look at it, please, it's fascinating. It's practically the account of human of human development, but this was a fascinating experience. The third part of the toys exhibition was my interest in unleashing a whole bunch of kids into these museums. I really wanted to create a different audience for museum spaces, not the carefully managed, you know, instructor will show you, well, children, this is the artwork. Okay, now make some neat drawings around it. Well, I was not interested in that kind of thing. I was interested in kids actually playing in the museum with the exhibits. So when I started working with the artists about this exhibition, I said, look, think about making works that are going to be durable, that are going to be safe, meaning you need to at least think about the fact that someone is going to be using it, and repeatedly so. So think about safety. Forget about ever getting this work back again in its exact form, because you're not going to get it. So think about make it durable to survive the exhibition, but acknowledge that this is not going to survive the exhibition. So it was, and many of the artists did not want to hear that. Many of them were very uncomfortable with the idea that things would be touched. And, you know, essentially some of them just dropped away. But we still had about 15 artists who participated in this exhibition. This is one of the works. It's called Bubbles. Are we online? I can just show you a short video. Okay, there we are. This is a documentation of a different space where this work was shown. So essentially it's an interactive work where is a motion recognition system that allows, that recognizes a shadow, and wherever there is a shadow, it detracts the bubbles. And every time that contact happens, there is a musical composition that accompanies it, that is automated. So you get the point. Let me just get out of here, go back to... okay, so, right. You saw that work. Now, can you imagine hundreds of kids every day coming in and playing that? And it was so much of screams. And the person who allowed me to use a gallery, the gallery director, was really unhappy. But that was the single largest, in terms of turnout, audience turnout, was the single largest exhibition they ever had, even now. They had hundreds of kids, hundreds of parents, adults coming in every day. And there were queues outside the gallery. It was a very small gallery, but it was popular because kids were enjoying themselves. Sometimes schools were organizing trips for the kids just to come in and play with these things. And again, the motivation was to really disrupt some of the economies of how museums operate as places for musing, not for amusement. And I think we need to reevaluate some of that if we really want to. Today many museums are in trouble in terms of audience base and losing their audience. And I've spoken to quite a number of museum conferences where this is exactly what I'm telling them. You know, get out of this habit of just thinking about the pristine artwork, because that ultimately is a notion that we need to challenge. If we want to truly engage people, truly engage the public, we need to ask fundamental questions about how we organize our space and our objects and our experiences. So this is, it takes cue from Magritte, but you know, it's a teddy bear that was made. But what this teddy bear was actually modular, so kids could. There was a whole pile of teddy bear parts that were actually constructed, reconstructed by kids throughout the exhibition. This is not the original work, but this is a later version of the work. I could not find the documentation of the original work, but this is an artist, Lim Shing Yi, a Singaporean artist, and she does these very large, this is relatively small, but for the exhibition she made a pretty large, as large as my body, right? Large round shapes, very much the texture of this creature, and it was constantly buzzing, you know, and it had made some occasional sounds when you came near it, and it was created like a complex organism, and again this was wildly popular among kids. They really enjoyed playing with it. It was meant to be played with. I'll go on to talk about another project that I really enjoyed doing, and it was also took on some of the issues that I'm interested in terms of travel. I talked about the fact that I like being in places where I'm uncomfortable, and I've had a couple of exhibitions where I've used travel as the framework for thinking about the exhibition. So this is one of the exhibitions where travel was an important part of it. So container culture was developed as part of a larger festival in San Jose. It was the ISEA, the International Symposium on Electronic Art. So I co-curated this with Steve Dietz, who was the artistic director for IZEA 2006. And basically, Steve and I were interested in the idea of connecting the different parts. So the exhibition was going to be in San Jose, but we wanted to think about using San Jose as a way of connecting the Pacific Rim ports. So many of the port cities of the Pacific Rim, both on the US side, on the Asia side, we wanted to find a way to connect them. So this is, and so that was the initial idea. And then I was very interested for a while with the idea of containers and, you know, the containers were developed in 1950. I mean, the containers that we have, the large containers that are used for shipping things were developed in the 1950s, very much as a way of standardizing the way in which you pack and the way you transport. So to create a modular system and an entire ecosystem of support that would, whether at the at every port, that would support that that particular kind of modular system. And it very quickly became the standard currency for travel, for trade and travel of goods and services. So San Jose was going to be the location for the exhibition, but we then started talking to curators in eight cities: Seoul, Beijing, Hong Kong, Mumbai, Singapore, Vancouver, Auckland, and Tokyo. You will notice that Beijing is not a port city, but they insisted on finding a way to connect to the theme. So we talked to them about it, and we ultimately found a way to get them involved. This was a really fun project because we had some restrictions on the curators. We said each city would have its own curator; they will select the artists themselves. Everything that they want to show needs to travel in that container, and the show needs to be in the container and will not spill out. Meaning, ideally, the exhibition space, once it moves to the San Jose, it needs to be still shown in the container. So these were the constraints we placed on them. Our initial idea was to actually have the exhibition at the Cesar Chavez Plaza in San Jose, for those who might know the space. It's a very nice plaza, and we initially wanted to place all the eight containers in that space. But between getting permits and security and the timing at which we will get the containers coming in, it was just impossible. So finally, we settled for doing it indoors. So the whole exhibition, the entire exhibition, not just this exhibition, but the entire IZEA 2006 exhibition happened in a very large warehouse in San Jose, and this was the final setup. We ended up getting containers arriving. Only eight containers arrived. The one from Mumbai did not arrive. Simply because the artist did not manage to put the artworks in place and get the permits in time to send the container. So we had an empty container with just the information that it did not arrive. But part of this was not about the success of whether we could get all of this. What were some of the concerns in what are some of the things that you can in fact transport? What are the restrictions on transportation and trade and travel? And interestingly, the Singapore work was taking cue with chewing gum. I do not know, most of you may know that Singapore has a restriction on the sale of chewing gum. Part of this is just that they've become obsessed with cleanliness to a point that they said, look, you know, we are not going to allow chewing gum to be imported, so people won't chew gum. But people still do chew gum, but they can't buy it. So two artists decided to actually talk about exactly the impossibility of importing chewing gum, and then the idea of how do we get enough chewing gum to export, to take out of Singapore. So they actually spent quite a number of trips out of Singapore in order to get a lot of chewing gum, enough chewing gum to make that large ball. And then they piled up the chewing gum in the container, and they had a nice kind of video work that dealt with the whole issue of chewing gum and trade between Singapore and the U.S., specifically around trade agreements and how trade agreements had complicated some of the chewing gum sales between Singapore and the U.S. So it was fascinating, the different kinds of issues that came up as a result of this exhibition. Okay, this is a, I'm just looking at the time, okay. So this is an exhibition that I was invited to serve as artistic co-director with a Japanese colleague of mine, Hiroshi Yoshiaka. Hiroshi and I have known each other for a long time, and so I jumped on the idea of just working with him. He's an amazing intellectual and a great curator. The Ogaki Biennale, this was the second installment of the Ogaki Biennale. Ogaki itself is a very interesting city. It's essentially an agricultural town that that suddenly found itself in the middle of an IT revolution. Because I do not know how much you know about Japanese politics, but one of the interesting things about Japanese politics is that every time a prefecture gets a new representative, government representative, they always will take on a kind of signature project. And the signature project of the person who actually became the kind of governor of the Ogaki Gifu Prefecture. Ogaki is about 40 minutes out from Kyoto, away from Kyoto. So the governor decided that he wanted to make this essentially agricultural town into the other IT capital. It was a strange ambition. They put a lot of investments and they built really humongous IT infrastructure. They wired up the entire town. If you know Japanese, internet penetration in Japan is one of the lowest among industrialized countries. And this small little agricultural town was suddenly everywhere there was wireless. But essentially it was had an interesting history. Ogaki was also the birthplace of Matsuo Basho, who is an important haiku poet. In fact, my adventures with Matsuo Basho began when I was doing my walking exhibition. I read his poems very extensively, because all his poems were generated as a result of the walks he made, and many of the walks were, believe it or not, around these areas. So it was a fascinating experience for me to be in that place where, you know, this poet and his relationship to land and nature was formed. So there is the IT capital thing, and then there is a Matsuo Basho relationship. It was also the winter palace of the emperor. So there were lots of very interesting architecture. There was a amazing palace that was surrounded by moats that people were using, that was lined with cherry blossoms. It's just a beautiful, beautiful city. The other aspect of it is that it also has the second largest concentration of Brazilians in Japan. So just in case you didn't realize, Japan has a very large population of Brazilians who migrated mainly in the 70s, and there was also a kind of exchange between Japanese and Brazilians moving back and forth. So the largest community of Brazilians is in Tokyo, and the next largest is in Ogaki. So we decided that, so when I came to the city and I started doing the initial scouting, I found all these rich relationships to the community, and so we started talking to artists. We invited some artists from outside. We invited altogether about 72 artists, and we installed about 75 works, 72 works, plus we had performances. We had screenings throughout a three-week period of the biennial. It was an amazing experience because we practically did not use a single art venue, because there were none. There was no art-specific space in that town. So everything we did it in public spaces that did not have a single relationship to the arts as such. So this is a work by Hisako Yakayama. It's called Kodama. Kodama is a Japanese Shinto religion, believes in the notion of natural spirits that inhabit the forest, and whenever you shout to them, the forest shouts back to you like an echo, but it reverses it like an echo. This work was, she did a project where a video, interactive video installation, where when you go into the space and you utter a word, that word is reflected back to you. And each of those bubbles that you see are, in fact, the voice bubbles of sorts. This was installed in a Shinto shrine, and it was an interesting negotiation because the Shinto shrine understood her work immediately. They said, "Yeah, of course, natural spirits. Yeah, Kodama. Yeah, of course. Yeah, of course, you want to place it here. Why would you not place it here?" So it was almost a kind of a natural fit, and I really enjoyed the fact that there was no discussion about, oh, is this the appropriate thing to do? And, you know, it was that kind of discussion, finding that perfect synchrony between the site and what we intend to do was really fascinating. And the work benefited from that space. This is actually a bank vault. This was an old bank that had been vacated. It had been vacated for a long time, and so this was a work by Rax Media Collective, which is an art collective based in Delhi, India. So this work is very much about documentation and surveillance and security and how information is kept secret and how information leaks. So this was all, this entire installation, video installation, was installed in these filing cabinets, which were already there in the bank vault, inside the vault. So people who wanted to see the work had to slowly open the vault ajar a little bit and go in. It was a great experience seeing people walking in and out of the vault, you know, and getting treasures of art coming out. This is a work that was also, as a sound work, that was also installed in a Shinto shrine. It's basically a perpetual sound machine. So every time you go into the space and clap or make a sound, one of the mics captures the sound, and all the other mics will replicate it, and then will just do it infinitely. So it will just go on and on and on and on until you know, that momentum goes away. It was eerie. This installation in that Shinto shrine, which was a pretty much a relatively sparse kind of Shinto shrine, it really worked amazingly, and the artists were extremely happy about this. This is the beggar robot. Basically, it's a reconfigured set of computers, old computers, that basically stands beside on the roadway and asks for money. So we collected quite a bit of money from this. What was amazing was that there were no visibly, at least we could not see anyone begging in that city. So this was especially interesting to see because the Pavel was from Europe, and where, you know, he saw it as a working very differently, the beggar robot working very differently, because there was a culture where begging was rampant, and this was a city where you could not see them. Maybe they are there, but we just could not see them. Okay, so this is one of the largest projects I've done thus far. Largest because it involved the most number of artists, most in terms of logistics, the largest number of spaces, and pretty logistically complicated spaces, all of them. And I worked with partner organizations in 12 countries. I raised over $2 million for this exhibition. And by the way, not a single dollar was from an art organization. So, you know, it's very strange, but this was a really interesting project to do. The International Symposium on Electronic Art is this nomadic festival that goes to different parts of the world. Each time, different cities bid for this symposium. The symposium consists of a large academic conference, a peer-reviewed conference, and a very large juried exhibition. What I decided to do with this exhibition this time around in Singapore was to focus on supporting the art creation rather than the exhibition. So I raised about $500,000 specifically to support artists being based in research labs, technology research labs that they chose. So we identified about 12 research labs of varying nature, you know, like a virtual reality research lab, a game lab, a lab that was working with computer vision, a research lab that was focusing on databases and data crunching and visualization. So a variety of different labs were identified, and then we listed it when and asked people to submit proposals to be a resident in one of these labs. And if they found other labs that they wanted to work with in Singapore, we will find a way to work, get them to work with that. So that was the call for proposals. We called for artists in residency proposals. The money that was raised was specifically to support them to be resident for 3 months in Singapore, in those spaces, support their travel costs as well as the accommodation, as well as their give them a materials costs, as well as support any other secondary travel that they are making as a result of the work. We selected 24 artists who developed 16 works. From the very beginning, I explained to the artists that, look, you know, and to the labs, that this is an experiment. You don't necessarily need to develop an artwork at the end of it all. You should feel comfortable to show what you end up with. It doesn't need to be a fully formulated work, and we will present it as an exhibition of the residency rather than an exhibition of artworks. That's what we did at the final exhibition. So these were some of the projects. This is a project by Clea Waite called Waterbook. So Clea worked with the Water Resources Research Lab in Singapore. Water is a scarce resource in Singapore, and I purposefully picked a number of artists whose interest was in water, because it has always been a politically contentious issue, and the economic and political and social cultural questions around water is fascinating in Singapore. So I wanted to play that out somewhat. So Clea's work basically she created an installation where you could access a whole series of information about water-related things by using a water-based book interface. So basically you duck your hands into each of these, you see words popping up that are specific to water and have a specific relationship to water, and when you touch that, then it opens up an entire file of other words and associations around water, which you can still navigate. So it was just from a back-end computer drawing a lot of data about water and making it accessible through the water interface. The museum did not like this exhibition, this work, because the kids were splashing and playing with it, and people were splashing water all around it. I said, oh, that's too much water, and we need to maintain it. And I said, it's okay. That's what it is. This is what the work is. What else can we say? This is a work by Eastwood, which is an artist collective from Serbia. So they wanted to actually create a critique of capitalism and the way it operates by hacking, doing a game hack of civilization, the game civilization. This is work. Matterhaven is a artist collective in Holland. So they were interested in exactly what has become commonplace now, but at that time they were really struggling to do this. It's really an aggregating system. So when you start looking for things, searching for terms, it starts generating it bombards you with a large number of active pages that all are related by way of content. So instead of seeing them as serial pages, you see them all at one go, and you can still manipulate them, but you manipulated them with a cursor. But this is, as you can see, the scale of that person standing there or sitting there. It's pretty high. It's about 12 to 13 feet high. This was the most low-tech work in the exhibition. It was the Korean artist Ji Hyun Oh, who basically decided to look at how a single word was being changed over time in Wikipedia. So every change that happened, she was recording it as one line on that sheet. So where's the cursor? I can't see. So every line you see on that paper, printed paper, is, and she actually printed it out physically. So she was very interested in the relationship between virtual labor and manual labor, the relationship between physicality of materials that you record in traditionally and the recording devices that you have through digital technologies. This is a work by a Filipino artist, Tat Amitano. Tat was very interested in musical composition, and he worked with setting up a robotic augmentation of a gamelan ensemble that was actually managed entirely by gestures made by a person who interacts in relation to the video screens. So the video screen is the one that is actually taking the cues, and that is sent to the robotic gamelan setup that then plays the music. So it's a twice removed relationship to music creation, but it was fascinating to see the relationship between delays, composition, idea of body as instrument. It was a really enjoyable work to curate. The last work I'll just showcase is Dance Local. Dance Local was really an attempt to, I was invited to co-curate with a Brazilian curator this time, an exhibition as part of the International Festival of Electronic Art and Video in Mexico City. So, and it was a great experience. So the premise we had was to think about the local not as somehow deficient, but the local as being dense, but made dense by the complex interactions it had with a global in a co-present way. So we were trying to think time and space together in relation to how globalization operates in localities. So we had an extended kind of philosophical, you know, text around this, but the basic premise was that the local experiences all the density, what it experiences as densities, and in fact the globalized relationships it has and cannot extricate itself from. So we were looking at selecting artists who brought some of those questions of that relationship between local and global, but by finding local registers for it. So this is where we did the exhibition, Laboratorio de Arte Alameda. This is a 17th century church. Maybe some of you know this already, but Mexico City has had huge difficulties with its churches. The churches have not been able to financially support themselves, so many of them are sold off. They sell themselves, or they are acquired by the government, and the government gives it away to art spaces. So there are two art spaces, Ex Teresa and Laboratorio de Arte Alameda in Mexico City, which are both churches that have been converted into art spaces. Ex Teresa is more for performances, and Laboratorio focuses a lot on new media. So you can imagine this is a church that was converted, so that it comes with this very peculiar qualities of what you can, what you have, what you don't have, whether you can rig it up in a way that would allow for technology augmentation. But it was a fun project. We worked with a Brazilian group called Eurasia that basically had they had set up a green screen where you could place yourself in front of it and create a variety of locations without ever going there. But part of it is to talk about the ability to displace oneself virtually in at a time when people are talking about globalization and localization. This is Edgar Andres Bondupont. And basically, what Edgar did was he collected things left behind by refugees in the Caribbean islands, from the Caribbean islands to very many parts of Florida. So he was basically going to the coast of Florida and collecting all these things that were left behind by people who came in boats, people who came in by different means to just, and they landed there and they left a lot of things in a hurry, either because of a raid or whatever. So he collected a lot of those things and he presented some of them, some of those objects in relation to the images that he harvested from those collections. So some of these images are images of people posing in front of spaces in their home countries, and these were found in their bags. But where they are, where they went to ultimately in the US or elsewhere, no one knows. But these are bags that have been washed ashore. This is a work by Alice Miceli. It's called the Chernobyl Project. It's a scary project by Alice. Basically, what she did was she spent a lot of time going to Chernobyl, the place where there's still active nuclear waste and radioactivity. She spent a lot of time taking photographs. But if you take photographs in a radioactive environment, this is what you get. You get images that are tremendously distorted because it does something to the camera and the film. And so she was doing these kinds of works and she presented them. They are amazingly ghostly. You can see sometimes outlines of landscapes. You can see outlines of a house or a flat, a dead animal. You can see all of that, but it's just eerie to see how radioactivity works on film. And you know, Alice tells me that she had no nuclear radiation effects, but you know, she did a brave thing, I think, for art. This is the last work I'll show from Dance Local. Ashok Sukumaran, an artist from Bombay. Ashok was very interested in electricity and electric grid as a way of organizing spaces and cities. And I've followed his work for many years now, and I invited him to do a project in Mexico. So what he did was fascinating. This was just a few days after Mexico Independence Day, and so he took one of those large light installations, which had the kind of Angel of Liberty or Angel of Independence. He reconfigured that Angel of Independence into a cone, a coin, and he also had the sign that says 12 pesos. And basically that sign points to this coin vendor on the other side of the road who sells coin. Now, Ashok was interested in the relationship between electric power, ethanol, which was increasingly displacing, which was increasingly putting demands on corn production in Mexico, especially after NAFTA. And so he was interested in the trade relationships and how they were changing the pricing of these, of the and the kind of corn that these vendors were being able to sell. And he wanted to put that twist on how independence is not really, you know, creating the independence for many of the kinds of activities that we have. Now, I wanted to end off a little bit with one project I'm excited about very much right now. As you can see, this is 2009, and my job has kept me extremely busy, but I've been brewing on a number of different projects. I've been working for a while on a project on religion and technology, looking at the relationships between technological objects and religious objects, and this is where I'm really interested in taking a variety of objects, religious objects, designed objects, artist works, artists creating work specifically for it, architectural spaces and things like that to compose an exhibition. I'm working on another project on books and libraries, specifically for the Michigan libraries. I'm really interested in the life of the book and the life of the library, both as space and as interface. The book as an interface and the library as space in relation to new technologies and how they're impinging it. I still have a lot of books, but I also am increasingly going to getting things on Kindle. I'm trying to downsize and giving away a lot of my books. But part of it is this fascination with the place of paper, the place of books, how books have become, I mean, people have a fetishistic relationship to books, and a fetishistic relationship to the library as well as their own libraries, and I'm very interested in how we can think that differently, but in the space of libraries themselves. So the proposal is to actually work in any of the libraries to artists, designers, architects, poets, performance artists, whoever wants to do this, to work in the libraries on a series of things. Filmmakers, I've not heard back from them yet, but I'm quite determined to do it. I'm also working on another project on the relationship between biology and machines for the American Museum of Natural History, but that's a four-year project which will involve zoosemioticians and nanobiologists and engineers and, you know, so a whole range of people, because the Museum of Natural History has a really amazing exhibition program that they undertake as a research project. So they do a lot of work, get a lot of different people together. So I'm beginning the project hopefully this summer, but that'll be a 4-year out project. So thank you.